Yeah, I don't know, man. You ever just feel like life is just catapulting towards some greater purpose?
Ever fat cats with bloated ego, we are
the only DJ crazy enough to tattoo Jackie Brown on his ass.
This is Michael Mann, and I ride with
Extended Clip.
And we're back on Extended Clip. Malcolm in the Middle, everyone's favorite segment. Malcolm, you watch anything in particular this week?
I did watch something, but here's something I watched in particular.
Yeah, I don't know why I phrased it like that.
Well, it was the perfect phrasing because I have a movie I particularly watched. It's this movie called Star Time. It's a slasher from the 90s, and it's kind of like a riff on Videodrome. It's someone who... it's like video. If you took Videodrome and Joker and you put them in a goddamn blender and you wanted to put that down your gullet, you might get Star Time. And... it's about this lonely man who's obsessed with this TV show, The Robinsons, and once it's canceled, he wants to kill himself. And a man who announces the lotto numbers on TV appears to him right before he's going to kill himself. He's like, no, we're going to make you a star. Like, you know, you have potential, but, you know, you got to go and kill some people for me. He's like, okay, it's like, this is what I have to do. I'll do it. And there's like a social worker who's the only person that talks to him. She gets involved with it. It's not exactly the smartest material, but I was impressed by like the way it was shot. It was a very well shot movie, more than like you would expect from fare like this. Almost getting like some Tsai Ming Lang vibes, and it's like the way it depicts lonely apartment living and like the barrenness and like these like kind of warped frames of just apartment living, these kind of like weird high angle shots of lonely men. And it was just really entertaining and shot well. And it was on Tubi, my favorite streaming service. So I got every time an ad came on, I would just check my phone for a little bit.
Yeah, Tubi's nice. It's like there's a built-in piss break. Exactly. You don't know when, but it's coming.
I think streaming services with ads are better than the ones without them, because it's like I miss ads now. Because I don't want to. I'm someone. I don't mean to brag, but I don't look at my phone when I watch a movie. I fucking watch that shit. But if it's a commercial on. Maybe I could, you know, do a little bit of that.
I just want to feel the return to normalcy after we've defeated COVID. I like to Applebee's to tell me welcome back, and that everything's fine again.
If I had time, what are you looking at on your phone during those movies, during those commercial breaks?
Just like Twitter or like Instagram, my messages.
Twitter, Pornhub, RedTube, X-Hamster.
The implication that I'm watching porn on my phone in between, that doesn't even make sense.
That's not what I was implying. That was JT's absurd chiming in.
If I had a time machine, I'd go back to 2005, though, for sure.
If I had a time machine, I'd go back to 30 seconds ago and tell you not to reveal that you were looking at. Never mind.
Couldn't land it. Next time, champ.
Quite. Yeah. Almost. JT, what about you?
I am going to reveal my ass here a little bit. Not literally, of course.
Yeah, we already shot the video for the Patreon.
But I recently, I want to try to dive deeper into Indian cinema. I mean, I know that's like a very big, broad term. Mm-hmm. I mean, if anyone has any recommendations of directors or particular flicks, please hop in my DMs. I would greatly appreciate it. But... we were talking about streaming services, and there's one here that doesn't have ads. You might have heard of it. It's called Netflix.
Well, I respect that one. That's the king. Salute to the king.
And
OG.
On it, Om Shanti Om is streaming. I had heard a lot of things about it. I was excited that it was like a big, like elaborate production, like about movies. The basic plot is that it's about... like an actor in the 70s who's like a junior artist, like an extra in like the background of movies, and he falls in love with like a big star at the time, but then he dies, him and his love, like together, like she's secretly married to another man and like is pregnant, and he's like a producer, and she's a big star, and he wants to keep that under wraps. But our hero dies trying to save her. Mm-hmm. And then he's reincarnated 30 years later as a just fucking pimp ass big name star.
That's what's up. Not
who's like afraid of fire because he has that memory of like dying in a fire, and he slowly sort of has those memories and is trying to like avenge the death of a love of his past life. And it just fucking goes so hard. Like all the musical sequences rule. Like he goes from this like kind of schlubby, clumsy actor in the 70s to just fucking ripped. He has like abs. He's doing like this great dance number with just busted women. And it's so like that contrast.
Nice.
Wait, busty or busted?
Like their titties are large.
Okay, that's busty.
Oh.
Busted
means ugly. Some ugly ass hoes.
I've heard it as busted as in their busts are
like
large.
I've only heard busted in a very, very derogatory sense.
All right, well, they're busty. The point is their tits are huge.
I know JT is a very sex positive man who has nothing but admiration for the female form.
but yeah, no, it's just that change in and of itself, like his character is like very different in that respect, is very funny. Yeah, I was just completely blown away. It's such a good time. It's one of those movies. I mean, this is a really hokey cinephile thing to latch on to, but a movie about movies that's really good, in that respect. And, it's a beautiful romance too. I would recommend checking it out if you haven't.
Yeah, that one's been on the watch list for a while. I also definitely need to take the plunge in general, so that's going to be one that I check out for sure.
It's like almost 3 hours, but it goes by so quickly. And
I got
just
nothing but time these days.
The way it divides up, like the first life in the 70s to like the present day, which is like 2007 at the time, is really good. It's like you're watching two movies for the price of one.
It's like Boogie Nights plus another movie, right? Because it's set in the 70s.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
What about you, Eddie? Have you watched anything this week?
Yeah, I remembered a couple of classics. I rewatched Samuel Fuller's 40 Guns from 1957, his black and white CinemaScope Western in which Barbara Stanwyck plays a high-riding woman with a whip, as noted in the song about her. So lovely. So, you know, that song, the first time it's sung, that cowboy sings it and he walks by the guy playing guitar, and I was reminded of There's Something About Mary and Jonathan Richman.
I miss the Farrellys.
Yeah, already miss my boys. But this is a film that is just so overwhelming with images and like sensations. You know, there's a sandstorm in here that is just like one of the most beautiful things. I mean, the high contrast black and white in CinemaScope, I'm not the first to point it out, but it's just every frame is really overwhelming. You know, Samuel Fuller is really dedicated to maximizing the potential of this format and also telling a very gritty and like hard-nosed but emotional story like he's so great at doing. And, yeah, I mean, you don't need me to tell you 40 Guns is a great movie. Everyone knows that.
That'd be 40 bullets on our scale.
Have you guys seen it?
Actually, I haven't, and I'm a big Fuller fan, so I need to get a nice 1080 rip of that because...
Oh, I got you.
Yeah, thank you, thank you.
I say you got to get a nice rip of this one because, like, that... the darkness is going to get totally compressed. If you stream it on Criterion Channel, good chance that darkness is going to get... super, super just like pixelated and garbage.
No, I've started this before and like I've been like, yeah, I need a better file for this because I'm getting the crunchy blacks and
I got you. Bring the hard drive next time.
Yeah, no, I've seen it and it rules. I don't know, Sam Fuller and Nick Ray and like a similar milieu for me where it's just like cool directors that were by.
Yeah.
Like it's that feeling washes through. I think there are a lot
the bathhouses on the tail end of that song in 40 Guns is just wonderful. It's just dudes having a bath.
Damn, I think people who are secretly bi might be the best filmmakers.
I mean, you can be openly bi, maybe
of course,
pretty good.
But just because
maybe pretty good.
You can get, but not the secretly bi This is, I don't know what I'm saying.
Yeah, I don't want to be one of those, like, yeah, buy Twitter filmmaker, on Twitter, where it's like, buy filmmakers use this kind of lighting and these plot devices.
But
and
secret buy filmmakers use these type of lighting, framing, and devices.
And men drive like this.
men and women, they're so different. That's what I'm learning by going on Twitter nowadays. It's like, men be like this, but then, you know.
But speaking of that, a Twitter phenomenon, the gun girl is well represented in 40 Guns. Not just Stanwyck, but, you know, at the gun store, the local gunsmith, where they handcraft these rifles for each person's measurements, and you know, you get a manic pixie gun girl, as it were, for the 50s at least, and it's a really wonderful performances across the board there, but of course Stanwyck really like holding it down in the center. What a great match for Sam Fuller. We'll be right back to talk about our B picture, Star Wars Episode II, Attack of the Clones.
Jedi, what do you know? Hey, maybe you could help with some deadbeats who owe me a lot of money.
My mother.
And we're back on extended. No.
Like the Fine Bros made a remix.
Whatever. Whatever. And we're back on extended clip after a tumultuous first half.
We haven't. Yeah.
What? Don't.
No.
Never mind.
Yeah, it was crazy we talked about for In Praise of Love.
Episode 2, Attack of the Clones, 2002, directed by George Lucas, the first major blockbuster to be shot on digital. It was shot on the Sony HDWF900. You know what else was shot on that camera? That very camera? Francis Ford Coppola's final trilogy of Tetro, Twixt, and Youth Without Youth. Steven Soderbergh's Bubble. The film All About Lily Shushu, which is great. Collateral by Michael Mann. Portions of Ali by Michael Mann.
This camera's got a great track record.
A Prairie Damn. Home Companion by Robert Altman.
I'm soy facing right now.
Rules of Engagement, the TV show. A lot of TV shows also use this camera, including the first season of The Office, I guess. But it's a landmark for early digital. And different cinematographers and directors got very different things out of it, to say the least.
No, yeah, I think Lucas is using it to full effect here. I mean, he's really exploring what he could do with digital technology.
Yeah.
I mean, that's an obvious appeal of this movie, kind of in, not in retrospect, because I'm sure smart people at the time noticed it, but like the you know, when people are bringing up prequels reclaiming, that's, you know, that's a big part of it. I mean, the landscapes here that, and like the color tones that Lucas is getting is just, it's downright beautiful in some parts.
Oh, no. I mean, the scene where Anakin is back on Tatooine and he finds out what his mother's fate was, you know, and he wants to go find her, and he hops on that, you know, sick hog and rides across that red sun, that red sky with the two suns. It's just one of my favorite shots in all of Star Wars, or all of cinema, really.
Definitely my favorite sequence of the film. I mean, it's a great film, but like that sequence in particular, once he rides over there, finds out what's going on, and you know what he does, and not to steal this, because I know we're all thinking this, but that iris cut out of the scene is just,
oh my god, just too amazing.
Money. It's
too
probably money. The most sympathetic one could feel during a genocide. Like, it's like I mean, because it's like
those Tusken Raiders are bad dudes.
Yeah, what were they doing there?
Like, remember when they shot at him during the pod race in episode 1?
that's called establishing the story. Right?
episode 1 available on the Patreon.
Check it out.
That was a great way to kill a conversation. I thought we could just move right past it.
But know? No, I think, like, I mean, episode 2 in general, the Anakin storyline of watching him, like, his descent into the dark side, if you will, I think this time around, because as a kid, I don't know, Attack of the Clones, I feel like if you like Star Wars even as a kid, but you're like, oh, the prequels are the bad ones, I feel like Attack of the Clones generally gets labeled as the worst because it's like boring.
Yeah.
But I think it's filled with a lot of really compelling stuff where it shows the contradictions in like the way the Jedi are training like Anakin to sort of like suppress emotion, and how like growing up in like poverty and sort of being pushed into it really clashes with that, and how it sort of pushes him to the dark side, and how he's like, I don't know, you feel a lot for him. Like, this is a very intense, like, emotional flick.
I mean, so the basic setup here is that after a attempted attack on the life of Padme, former queen of Naboo, now a galactic senator, Amidala, moving into a more global territory, as we on Extended Clip are global cinephiles, not globalist cinephiles. I think this movie is a cornerstone of that philosophy.
Absolutely.
We'll get into the politics as we go. But, you know, the political thread of this trilogy is very, like, deeply woven into, like, the character arcs, you know, their emotional arcs, as well as, like, the politics of this whole world that Lucas has created. And so it opens on an attempted assassination of her. And so the duo at the helm here of young Anakin Skywalker, about 10 years after the events of the first film, as a as an adolescent, an angsty teen, a rebel with a cause, if you will.
Yeah, yeah.
And Obi-Wan Kenobi training him, are split as Obi-Wan goes to investigate the attempted terrorist attack, and Anakin is sent to safeguard the senator, but eventually they go on a mission of their own back to his home planet of Tatooine.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you said in the, when we talked about the first Star Wars, that, you know, the Jedis are cops, and it's very felt in this one, where it's like, literally, you start with a high-speed buddy cop chase with, you know, Anakin and Obi-Wan. I'm still getting used to the character names. It's going to be a hump.
Look, newcomers are welcome here. We've always said fuck lore on Extended Clips. So if anything is wrong that we say about Star Wars, I don't fucking care.
That's true. That's true. And then Ewan McGregor, he goes off, and then he kind of has like his own like Columbo detective, you know, almost. It's almost structured like in parts like a police procedural show. Then you have the subplot of like the romance that Anakin is experiencing, which is, I agree, is very well done. And I love the angsty aspect of it, just because he's a young hustler on the come up, and people are trying to get him down. He feels like he has so much potential, but, you know, people are in his way. He wants to be the best.
I mean, the film, for the most part, for about, you know, it's about 2 hours, 20 minutes. I would say about an hour and 10 minutes of this is cutting back and forth between, you know, Obi-Wan on his little detective mission, where his search for a bounty hunter uncovers, you know, the clone army that will be used in the Clone Wars. And meanwhile, Anakin is, you know, resisting temptation with falling in love with the woman he's being paid to, or not paid to, but part of his duty is to protect. And then, of course, his very heavy, melodramatic return home, finding the fate of his mother. And then it all kind of comes together wonderfully in the third act, just like, you know, not actually kind of an inverse of how Phantom Menace was structured, as Phantom Menace is building up to the third act being cut across multiple planes. You know how we talked about that on the Patreon episode, how there's like four planes of action that it's cutting across. This one, the third act, brings all the characters together who were apart for the first, you know, 2 hours almost.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, like it goes into that big war sequence, and that's what I was impressed with too. Something I was impressed with the first one, like how long it would, like, the pod racing sequence was allowed to be. But even like something like the opening chase is so long, but I feel like it lives up to its like full potential, where it's like, I don't know, maybe a lesser filmmaker would try to reduce the length of this movie, but I think it's perfectly long.
Yeah.
I mean, right from the get-go, like, the stunts that happen, like, Obi-Wan just, like, fucking jumps out and, like, latches on to the little droid that causes the worms that are coming for Padme, the bugs. Yeah.
And I love how right before that you see their reluctance. You know, they're already upset with their job protecting this woman. You know, Anakin obviously is very infatuated with her. He's thought about her every day since he was a little child. But Obi-Wan is very over it already, like a cop who's disinterested in his current work. And what does he say? He's, you know, trying to tell Anakin not to simp for her. He's like,
and don't forget, she's a politician, and they're not to be trusted.
And one of my favorite lines is right after that, when Anakin says, "Oh, Obi-Wan, not another lecture, especially not on the economics of politics."
The economics of politics.
I mean, it's like, that's part of the, I think, relatable stuff that, like, people really don't jive with about this film is that, like, Anakin for a lot of it is just like an angsty teen. And, like, especially like the point where it's like he's joking about fascism with Padme. It's like a young boy flirting with libertarianism. It's like he's misguided and wrong.
Sounds an awful lot like a dictatorship to me.
Well, if it works.
If Padme was more a sexy Ilhan Omar type, she could have led him in a better path.
No, I think that's what's great. A big part of what I like about this movie is that it's using this huge, you know, expensive world with expansive characters and different worlds in which have different landscapes, and it's using that as a backdrop for a romance. Like, very heavily, where it heavily invests in the melodrama, not only, you know, in the script where it's talking about, I think he says, like, now that I'm with you, I'm in agony. I'm haunted by the kiss that we once shared. If I can't have you, you know, almost going straight, you know, Shakespearean.
Yeah.
But also the, you know, these digital landscapes reflect kind of the melodramatic feelings that are being exchanged here. And it's just, it's a great pairing. And it's, you know, Lucas is great with the digital technology. And I think he had a great handle on it right from the jump.
Yeah, I mean, rather than digital textures interacting with 35 millimeter in episode one, this one is just full-blown digital CG everything. They're very open about it, too. You know, the DVD supplement documentaries are on YouTube, and those behind-the-scenes documentaries are amazing, watching them make this movie. But that opening chase, though, yeah, he's right away establishing the freedom that he has with the camera in these digital landscapes. He can just go into multiple axes like of direction for this car chase. He can, instead of just going forward, back, left, and right, you can just dip up and down too, because it's this floating, you know, flying car highway. So it's just like all axes of direction are capable, and his camera is so attentive and the framing is so perfect because they can perfect it rather than having to chance it, like so much great action cinema with practical effects and celluloid, you know, film had to do in the past. It's just a whole new way to make action cinema.
And I think it's really like fulfilling its potential in like other facets of like maybe like how it establishes the setting even better too than, let's say, the first one. And the first one has great production design, and that's something, you know, you notice with these movies because there's a lot of it. But it, like, this is better in a different way where it's like it feels so expansive, and I get like a real sense of area around all the different settings that these characters travel to. And that's another thing I like about these movies, all the different, you know, little worlds and, you know, places that they
the
travel 50s to.
The 50s diner. I mean, of course, George Lucas had to throw that in there with Dex. I love how also they go to a bar before that. When they're in the club, it's so sick. You get a POV shot of like Anakin, like Copacabana, Goodfellas style, like him rolling through the club. And that club has like pod racing and droid football on the TV. And like a guy trying to sell him some death sticks. And it's an awesome environment. The 50s diner is dumb, but that's like the first scene of Obi-Wan on his detective story. And like that two shot of him with Dex, that fucking disgusting four-armed creature who runs the establishment, sitting at the booth together, you know, that low angle and kind of dark lighting, it immediately keys you into like the genre background of this. And Lucas is a fucking god. He can't be stopped in this film. Like, he's pulling off so many stylistic maneuvers that I didn't think he had in him, and he's clearly like exploring, you know, what he can do with these digital textures, as opposed to episode three, where I think he's more perfecting it, you know.
No, I think with the like, to speak on the digitalness of this and how it affects cinematography, when it is going for like these darker sequences, the way like digital technology or how they were just using it at the time to capture like these deep darkness, like dark tones that, like, I think just shadows kind of hit differently under like a, you know, a digital camera. And seeing him work with that in a
A lot of those shadows are completely artificial.
Yeah, put exactly.
It in post as well. Yeah.
I mean, well, there you go. See, I'm learning new stuff every day. But yeah, that's what I'm seeing, I guess.
Yeah.
It's like this just different texture of darkness.
And, you know, you have that wonderful set piece of Anakin and Padme trying to get out of that droid factory where they get put on the assembly line, you know, and it's super goofy. Just like each of them gets a different part of the assembly line to go through. But the obstacles that they have to go through, that couldn't have been accomplished with practical. That's like one of the most ridiculous set pieces ever. But I love.
Yeah, no, I like the, I mean, we talked a little bit on the Patreon with the Phantom Menace, But I like the juxtaposition with the set pieces there with the, like, the political stuff, because I think, I mean, often derided the prequels as movies for babies. There is so much, like, intellectually going on here with, like, the processing of, oh, there's this hidden army we've discovered that we sort of have to inscript now to use and grant wartime powers to the Chancellor. And on top of that, just like, I mean, what Malcolm was saying with sort of the detective story with Obi-Wan, there's a, and like relating the Jedi to sort of like fascist cops in a way where I at one point he says to Anakin that this weapon is your life, referring to like the lightsaber, and just how all that like unfolds there with them, like, I don't know, very, it's very similar to real police where it's like a very unrealistic expectation to have these people remove their emotions from their decision making ability, and just Anakin is like the perfect character to show how that sort of breaks and collapses.
Yeah, and especially the wartime powers being put forward at the Senate by none other than Representative Jar Jar Binks.
In response to this direct threat to the Republic, Mesa propose that the Senate give immediately emergency powers to the Supreme Chancellor.
I thought that was a great touch and like a good response to people who disliked Jar Jar Binks in the first one. It's like Luke's just like, this is a respectable guy here. This guy's a stand-up guy, real solid motherfucker.
Dude, he transcended like the interspecies hate of his home planet and the secret underwater city that he lived in, and he became a representative of Naboo under Amidala, and it's a great, you know, stepping across the aisle example.
Mr. Binks goes to Washington.
That is, yeah. Oh, that, I guess that's the episode title. I was gonna do something about like the two movies together, but fuck. That's,
In praise of Star Wars.
Yeah, no, that's just. Come on. We're better than that.
We are.
Also, I love. I mean, if you've seen the third one, you know how fucking hilariously devastating it is when Obi-Wan goes to talk to Yoda about this planet that seems to be deleted from the databases and the archives, and Yoda's training those younglings. And if you know the fate of the younglings in Episode 3, it's honestly, I laugh every time I see. They're just having a good old time. Little do they know the events of Revenge of the Sith. But it is great where Obi-Wan's journey takes him, you know, discovering this army, and, you know, all their plots come together as they are both sentenced to execution by way of crazy alien monster in like a gladiator type arena, and then all three main characters are together at last. And also the other thread that had been cut in between, not as much as the main two though, was Samuel L. Jackson, of course, as Mace Windu, and with Yoda back at like the Jedi Council base, and those scenes of them talking, like, yeah, they're pretty expositional, but I love the way it's shot, just like those, you know, neon bars behind them, and just like Jackson interacting with CG Frank Oz as convincingly as possible.
No, I like those scenes too. Like, you know, normally, you know, people poo-poo exposition. I do too, but it's like the way it's framed, it's like just these two Jedi masters pontificating in a room about basically what's happening and the context of what's happening, I think is a good way to put it too. And it's, you know, it's arguably dialectical. Diabolical.
There's something there. We're on our Jean-Luc George Lucas tip today. So. Yeah,
exactly. I had to use that word.
Okay, so the monster fight at the end that presages the Clone Wars is like surprisingly pretty bloody. You know, you get some like human blood in this. That one like pincher thing that's like trying to pinch Obi-Wan. There's like a red spray of blood across the camera kind of. It's like very gory for Star Wars. And then, you know, the battle keeps upstaging itself as more droids and then Jedis enter. And, you know, we talked about Terrence Stamp in the first one. He was ousted by Chancellor Palpatine, of course, and as the Chancellor. But in this one, now we have Count Dooku, played by Christopher Lee. Just the fucking god. Like, his presence in this is so funny and, like, so, like, powerful still with that slight humor in it too. Like there's a slight camp quality, but it's still also pretty menacing.
Master Windu, you have fought gallantly. Worthy of recognition in the archives of the Jedi Order. Now, it is finished. Surrender, and your lives will be spared.
We will not be hostages to be bartered, Dooku.
Then, I'm sorry, old friend.
Mm-hmm. I think Dooku is a funny name. That was my reaction.
Oh, yeah. I'm always feeling like Count Dooku.
I was like, damn, yeah. That's literally what I said to him. I was like, damn, I'm feeling like Dooku.
But so at the climax of the film, after the huge ground battle, you get a lightsaber duel, kind of like the first one where you had Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan against Darth Maul. Here you have Anakin and Obi-Wan against Count Dooku, and they cannot withstand his finger lightning. So that is, I guess that's the first chronological use of that finger lightning thing that happens in those movies sometimes, which is always scary and overpowerful. Mm-hmm. But then he fights CG Yoda, and dude, Yoda flipping all over the place.
That fucking
twirling.
Rules.
I love it. It's amazing. And Christopher Lee just like, I mean, the behind the scenes, you see how much the body double does in that.
Yeah.
But like his ability to act against CG Yoda flying all over the place is pretty impressive.
No, yeah. To give a lot of the actors credit in this movie, at least to me, it seems like they're interacting with these CG actors really well. And like, there's like maybe a couple times where I'm feeling, you know, the computer generation of it where it kind of looks like very fake, or I'm just feeling it a little bit more, but honestly it's never something that really bothered me, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think part of the beauty of the fakeness of it is that like Lucas is able to explore all these different types of genres. Mm-hmm. Like
True,
a different, like with the different settings we were talking about, it's like you get the detective story, you get like the big sort of Roman epic movie at the end. It's just so mind-boggling and impressive to me that he has something that works on a really complicated intellectual level about like bureaucracy's descent into fascism, while also like just jumping around within different film genres about like guys playing with laser swords.
So this is just a really great film in my opinion. F the haters. You get all of that like expressionist early digital experimentation, and you have that young love captured so sentimentally, and ending on that wedding is one of my favorite final shots in all of the Star Wars. The best final shot of any Star Wars though is episode one with that Augie's Imperial March playing. You got the guy holding the orb. But yeah, this film ends beautifully, and it always takes me like aback how much people hate this, but we're not here to be those guys. We're not here to be, the critics said this, but actually no, it's this just on its own. It's a great film. Four bullets for me.
Yeah. I'm going to give it four bullets as well. I mean, just talking about it, you know, I need to watch the third one because I these are movies I haven't seen before.
Pray for the younglings before
the younglings.
You do.
I know. I was going to say it. Shout out to the younglings. But I was really impressed on like how entertained, like, because like Phantom Menace, I appreciated a lot of it and I was entertained in parts. But this movie really entertained me on like a blockbuster level and is like doing things you'd expect blockbusters to do with advanced technology. Like you were saying, JT, like exploring different settings, getting in as much, giving like the universe that he's creating as much depth as he wants to. He's not really shackled to any physical limitations, and you know, this is what you'd want to see with digital technology. And you know, but I feel like movies aren't exactly doing this. They might have taken like, because like you've seen those ugly Marvel movies where like digital landscapes, they saw Lucas do it, but they didn't quite get the they don't quite have the stroke he does as a as a painter. But yeah, what do you think, JT?
I'm also giving this one four bullets. It is a great damn movie. And I'm probably going to watch Sith in the coming days just to check in, because I'm a prequels boy now. But I don't know. It, like, in watching both of these films this week, it really took me aback by how complicated it is and like how much I missed as like a kid, because it's like I said on the Patreon, but it's like you can simplify it down to like Jedi is good and the Sith bad, but you see here happening in Anakin's descent into becoming Darth Vader that like Palpatine is just telling him like trust your feelings, just like all like generally kind of good advice, like where it's like, yeah man, you should like kind of feel this out sort of stuff, like, and the Jedi being so bent on like repressing and just trying to be logical and cold, which like clearly won't work out. It's such a great flick.
And there's just so many fun little alien guys. Mm-hmm. And our favorite guy that we already talked about on the earlier recording, Watto, is back, and he has a little hat now and a little more a little more facial hair as well.
He looks shaggier than ever.
Yeah. So that's going to do it on that. As I load up the inbox, you can always email us at extendedclippodcast@gmail.com. Our first one is from Ryan Kelly email. He hasn't hit us up in a while.
He was one of the original emailers, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, this guy definitely has the record for the most emails read on pod, and a lot of them were quite good, too.
Yeah, yeah. I think the first one was a little shaky, but then he stepped up his game and became great, you know?
This one looks like he sent it to the wrong podcast. this one is definitely like a Doughboys email. The subject is Roast Spoon Man, and the content is... Have you guys tried the Wendy's breakfast yet? Anything I should get? My nickname for Mitch is the Fast Bastard. From Ryan.
There's not a Wendy's near where I live, unfortunately. A lot of other great fast food places, but I would attend Wendy's more often, but unfortunately it's like 20 minutes away and I'm not gonna I don't know. I'm not going to trek like that.
A roommate of mine recently went on a bad acid trip. Ooh. And he, the day after, got the Wendy's breakfast. And I think it did him well. So I'm going to say it's good.
I'll endorse it. I endorse Wendy's. I don't care who the owner's donating to for president.
I love Wendy's. I haven't tried the breakfast yet. I live near one. We've gone to it before. Mm-hmm. When restaurants used to be open. It was fun. It was one of our extended clip dining spots.
Yeah. Extended clip patio series.
Oh, no. We're not doing that nonsense. No.
Nonsense.
Next email is from Valerie, another email Hall of Famer. Subject line, cars.
Oh, shit.
Hell yeah. Hey, fellas. Right now, I'm drunk and watching Cars pass from my balcony. And since the king himself, George Lucas, is a self-described car guy, that's the question I'm asking today. What are your favorite car scenes? What is your favorite car from TV or film? Do you prefer a car scene where the car's intact or it gets destroyed? Hopefully, this email is sent in time. LMAO. Sincerely, Valerie. You got it just under the wire. I'll say that much.
Hmm.
I mean, I have a list on Letterboxd entitled Ghost Ride the Whip. That includes a lot of my favorite movie scenes with cars, but off the top of my head... I will say one of my favorite cars in TV and movies is discussed on our Fairley Brothers episode. The dog car from Dumb and Dumber, of course. But also car scenes. I mean, David Cronenberg's Crash has quite a mm-hmm. few good car scenes in it where some cars are destroyed. Some are kept intact while it's more bodily damage being done.
Mm-hmm.
I love a good car crash. I mean, as said in Death Proof, real cars smashing into real cars. And that's another automotive classic. Let's see, Getting Any by Takeshi Kitano is a film about trying to get a car so you can have car sex.
This is like a pretty basic ass choice, but a classic for me, Christine. I really love mm-hmm. it. Like, I don't know, I can really fuck with that 50s vibe and just like, the idea of like a young boy falling in love with his car is really funny to me.
Yeah.
And it makes me think there's like in V by Thomas Pynchon, like the main character, Benny Profane, there's like a little subplot where he sees from afar his like girlfriend like talking to his car and like that she wants to fuck it. And it's just like, I like the I don't know. I feel like cars are generally the most fuckable inanimate objects. I didn't mean to lead into this point when I was starting this sentence.
You ever seen the caboose of a train?
I'm not I'm not attracted to cars or trains.
I feel like something softer would be.
I just feel like cars are generally what people sublimate a lot of like sexual desire into.
All right. Thinking of cars, this is a stupid answer, but I'm reminded of Hurricane Heist, directed by Redacted. Don't look up who directed it. But there's a great vehicle in that movie, a movie that's not great, to be honest, but that's a vehicle that could withstand anything. It could get shot at. There can be a tornado. It's going to stay in place. It's going to stay intact. And they use that car to great effect. They fuck things up with it. A scene I'm thinking of is from The Driver, and I think that's just coming up because it has the word drive in it, so I'm like, car movie.
Yeah,
linked up. That is a great movie. And there's a scene where Ryan O'Neal, the lead character in the movie, is being hired to, you know, drive for someone, but he's insulted that he even has to try out, so he takes their car and just drives it around a parking garage, fucking it up, like intentionally crashing it into pillars, like... He's showing he could still fuck up and do a great job. And it's just, I mean, talk about real cars on real cars into real concrete. You know, I'm into that too.
Also, I want to shout out Supervan from 1977, a film about people who trick out and paint their vans and go to van derbies where there's like a mud hill climbs and races. And also just people like... It switches from like a vansploitation thing where it's like a race, and then there's this like futuristic van settling in, but there's also these two extended like party scenes that are all shot on handheld and feel more like a documentary, and they might just be documentary footage really, because it also ends on documentary footage of all of these people's custom vans, their paint jobs, which are all very funny. But yeah, it's just like all these van culture people like drinking and smoking in the 70s and having a good old time. And
yeah.
I gotta give my highest recommendation to Supervan.
You mentioned Crash, and I had this thought like a couple days ago, because, you know, that's about people who get into car crashes, want to have sex because of it. Very simplistic way of putting it. But I was thinking, like, I get a big rush when I almost crash into someone. Like, I love that feeling, and I don't do it intentionally.
Yeah. No, I know. Yeah. My dad took me to like some motorcycle races as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
We saw some Moto Grand Prix. For all you Europeans out there, you might know the Moto GP more than our American listeners. My dad used to tell me, like, Moto GP, oh, in Europe, it's as big as like football is here. Definitely not true. But he took me to see a race, and like there was this crash, and like, or like we were watching footage or something like that, but it comes up, one of his friend's kids asks him, like, so do you like want to see them crash?
Yeah.
My dad just like thinks about it for like a minute, and he's just like, I like a good near miss.
See that? Yeah, I like a good near miss too, but I was like, I want to keep the sexual aspect on it. I want people who like almost crash and then fuck, because on that high, on that adrenaline rush, you know?
The beginning of Sofia Coppola's Somewhere, where Stephen Dorff is just driving in circles, apparently based on her cousin, Nicolas Cage, doing that in real life.
Mm-hmm.
You got Southland Tales. Come on. Real cars, fucking real cars. the driving scene in The Birds when she approaches Bodega Bay is like one of the best of all time. That's enough. You can donate at patreon.com/extendedclip or at extendedclip69 on Twitter. I'm at iPod_video.
I'm at Bitchface Palace.
I'm at Tall Boy Thin Legs.
And what are we talking about next week?
In the Patreon, if you're curious, we talked about Phantom Menace. And there's a little actor, Terrence Stamp. We've mentioned him before. I really like the presence he had, and so I'm curious which y'all prefer, Pimp Mode or Chimp Mode, Terrence Stamp. There are two films. The A feature is The Collector by William Wyler, where I think Terrence Stamp has like a kidnapped a woman and like put her in the basement, I think.
That's Pimp Mode?
Not like Pimp Mode, not in a good way. Pimp Mode in the sense of owning a woman.
Oh, so now you're being a swerf.
but yeah, that's Pimp Mode. And Link is the follow-up to that. Where I think he has some part in some missing link chimp that will probably go crazy.
Oh, that sounds fun.
I'm going to go ape for that, man.
That launches me into my Patreon selection because Link is by Richard Franklin. And we're going to be talking about Psycho 2, the follow-up to everyone's favorite blockbuster film.
Nice. That sounds very fun. I can't wait. I've had Psycho 2 on my watch list for quite a few years now, so very excited to get into that. Once again, $2 a month. You get all that shit, baby.
Just two. It's just two.
Okay, we'll see you next week.
On YouTube, I feel like people, it was just more of a topic of discussion. Like I was in a class, like an English class, and we had to do some in-class writing. She would be like, oh, I'm going to put on anime lo-fi.
Really?
Yeah.
What grade was this?
This was like 2 years ago in college.
Oh, in college. Okay. Still, because I was going to say, because I remember the innovation of that when I was in like, I think junior, senior year of high school, I found some of those playlists on YouTube and I was very into it.
Hell yeah.
You got a 17-year-old me, what kind of music I like? Let's see. I like indie rock. I think by then I was fully rejecting classic rock, but still liking Led Zeppelin.
Yeah, yeah. In private.
But I also liked, you know, like more like, you know, underground hip hop.
Yeah.
Not 17-year-old me saying that. Just like pitchfork ass opinions about hip hop as a 17-year-old. But I loved like Dilla and Madlib. And I even dipped my toes into a little bit of the New Jobbies or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And like that is definitely the spawn of all of that.
Oh, you definitely know,
chill,
definitely.
Lo-fi beats to study and be anime to.
That's like if that, I mean... It's like that's the good version of lo-fi anime beats to chill to.
I just can't study to lo-fi beats.
I need hi-fi.
Yeah, no, I my study music would be like something, I mean, instrumental.
Yeah.
But Philip Glass usually, ooh, like the Koyana Scotsy score, that's really good. There's one track, The Grid, where it's like, it's really going hard.
Hell yeah. I still go with the beats for writing and stuff, like Pete Rock's Pete Strumentals. I like that because the tracks are longer, more like 4 or 5 minutes compared to, you know, like stuff like Jay Dilla, you can't study or write to because it's so active and the tracks are 45 seconds to 90 seconds long. You know, you can't study that.
Can't dig in. No, yeah, that's why I kind of like more like maybe like ambient or like ambient dub, like something like Aphex Twin or like Jan Jalinik or something like that. You know, these foreign names. But yeah, that's just talking about study music.
Yeah. You guys want to start the podcast?
Yeah.
We got a long one to do. We got to do the Patreon after that, too.
True. Yeah, exactly.
We've got a long night ahead of
Fuck
us,
me.
Boys.
All right, guys, we got to actually start it.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to Extended Clip, episode 61. I'm one of your hosts, Eddie Averill.
I'm Malcolm Baum.
I'm JT White.
Didn't say a different name that time.
No, I was tempted to say Malcolm Star Wars fan.
Remember when you said like Barstool Malcolm?
That was pretty good.
I loved that. That was one of my favorite intro bits.
We'd love to remember the classics here at Extended.
I might need to bring the Barstool stuff back. Maybe some more
Barstool. They're back in a big way. I don't know if you've heard of the news about journalism.
That was a great interview, by the way. Good interview. Check it out. BarstoolSports.com.
That like one day if we have someone we really love on the podcast, that doesn't happen to us and people are just like, why didn't you ask Woody Allen about like that stuff? Like, you were just letting him walk all over you.
That's not someone we really love. I'm not gonna say that. No, not falling into that hole.
I got a special type of love for the Woods.
What if he came on pod though? You would say you loved his films.
Yeah, I guess I would suck dick.
Yeah. To be honest, I don't even like. I'm not even like a Woody. You guys are the people who are actually into Woody Allen. I don't even really watch Woody Allen films.
Okay.
So you got.
Okay.
Start pointing fingers.
All I'm going to say is I want to ask him, like, a follow-up, because in an interview once he said that he discovered Justin Timberlake while he was watching The Social Network on the treadmill.
Damn, I was going to, yeah, I was listening.
I just want to fill out that whole scenario, that whole day, you know?
give me a day-to-day. No movie talk.
Well, that's that book that was written most recently. It was like a day in the life of a production. Not even a day. It follows the production.
In praise of Woody.
I think it's of Wonder Wheel, but it might have been the one before that.
Okay.
But it's just like a start to finish movie making process of what he does every year, you know? And that one's pretty recent, too. So I'm blindly recommending a book who I don't know the title or author of, but I know that it exists.
That's about Woody Allen,
just how he makes movies.
True, the total, you know, he's a filmmaker.
I'm not talking about the new Woody Allen book that he wrote.
True, yeah.
Apropos of Nothing, which, what a fitting title, man. We're late on this one, but
see this book that came out.
You met this guy's. Oh yeah, I'm one of your hosts. It's Jay Leno.
I love art house films.
We were doing street cred Jay Leno in the break, and well, folks. That's what you pay the big bucks for.
Yeah,
no, we're not even going to record that for Patreon.
The off mic bits.
Yeah, that's DSA what you pay for. Rodney Dangerfield.
Oh yeah, none of those are ever. None of those beloved characters are ever making it to Mike.
True. I might have to pen the DSA Rodney Dangerfield.
Right. Do you want to just start the episode over?
Sure. We did talk about Woody Allen for like 5 minutes.
Welcome to Extended Clip, episode 61. I'm one of your hosts, Jay Leno.
I'm one of your hosts, Malcolm Star Wars Bomb.
I'm fucking JT White.
And you're over the nonsense.
Let's just get to this fucking podcast already. We have so much ahead of us. We have to record a Patreon episode. I'm just trying to keep us on track.
We're fooling around for sure.
Do you remember their names? Maybe nothing was said. This is spoken in the beginning of In Praise of Love, and it's also said at the end. And it kind of makes a perfect loop for this film. You know, it's a film with a break an hour in where the time is reset and the events leading up to the first hour are portrayed. And, you know, you get a couple lines that cue you into what Godard was doing structurally. If you didn't already look at the Wikipedia for the film or the episode description for the podcast. But this is a film where the first hour, as I said, I didn't say anything about it yet, but the first hour, as I remarked, as it being one movement of the film, is shot on film in black and white, shooting the streets of Paris for the first time in, 30 years for Godard? Like, just like this free-flowing, you know, almost a callback to the new wave style. But that's just to lure you in, to lay the heavy truths on you that Godard is telling in this film. You know, you got Spielberg coming right at you. You got Hollywood as American imperialism coming at you. The war crimes that are being committed across the world. Godard is going to cover almost all of them. He tries to touch all the bases here in one of his most classic films. I loved this one.
Mm-hmm. No, I love this too. And, you know, you remarking on the call-outs Godard is doing here. And, like, that's something I always love about Godard is that he's willing just to kind of not even digress, because that's the whole part of the movies that he gets to do these things. But it's like... he just has guns out for people. He's, you know, he hits a target, and that's a big reason why he's on the logo holding the fucking gun, because he's a shooter for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, Godard is going sicko mode in this. This is like, I don't know, I feel like in some of the ones that I like a little bit less, it's like less coherent, and you can't, like, you understand where he's coming from, but not, like, it doesn't cohere into anything. And this just, like... I don't know. The juxtaposition of the black and white film versus the digital, it just all of it, like, flows together so perfectly. And, like, so many of what so many points that he's getting at are, like, clear and explicit. Mm-hmm. And just, it's a beautiful film. One thing that I noted in this flick, there was a great double feature that I could see at a theater. The Pickpocket, The Matrix. My God, put me at that Cineplex.
I know, right? And then doesn't it come back around later where there's like a little girl at the door knocking, like signing a, like showing a petition to sign to translate the Matrix into some sort of language.
Yeah. The Matrix being next to Pickpocket there, you know, make what you will of it.
Yeah, Wachowski auteurism wasn't as strong then.
Yeah, but at least, like, I there were at least people reading into the Baudrillard, you know, simulation. True. French philosophizing bullshit stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't want to say bullshit. Matrix is, like, a masterpiece. So, you know, I'm joking around when I say bullshit there. But not to belabor our point that was made about Star Wars already being belabored about how, like, people didn't get it at the time, and then there's revisionism. Mm-hmm. American critics, not really big on this, and it may have had to do with the New York Film Festival premiere within a month of 9/11. The anti-American sentiment in this film is as strong as Godard has ever been, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. And it rules, too. It's like,
oh, it's great. I mean, it's all, like, very pointed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Saying that, you know, there's an absence of culture there, and that we, you know, we take other tragedies, and then little do we know, right around the corner, a big tragedy of our own. 9/11.
I mean, coming hot off of 9/11, just, like, it makes it... it makes it even more poignant, because he's, like, talking about, like, just that we, like, Americans will create images, like, meaninglessly, and that, like, there's no sense of, like, a dialogue with the past, where it's just, like, completely divorced from that type of thing. And it's all very true. Like, I mean, not to go too much into, like, oh, the contemporary viewing of this, but I don't know. It just feels... like, I don't know, it's as relevant as ever.
Mm-hmm. I mean, now, you know, you look at 9/11 nowadays, and most people who are, like, under, like, 15, they just laugh at the concept of, like, 9/11. Like, you know, it's become completely, you know, it's been reinterpreted.
9/11 these days? Let's see what they're doing to it these days. Anyway, so this film, you know, Edgar is the protagonist, as it were, and you know what you're going to get in terms of how fractured the narrative is going to be with Jean-Luc Godard, our old friend. But he's embarking upon some sort of narrative project that is to capture, you know, these four stages of love that he maps out, you know, as a grand structure of romantic arcs. And he's not sure, is it an opera? Is it a film? We'll see. I mean, we're watching it. It's a film.
Yeah.
But yeah, you get all these, like, beautiful, high contrast, shadowy, black and white images of Paris. A concept that's introduced early on, because, like most Godard at this point, like, the plot just happens around the characters. The characters, their dialogue doesn't move plot forward. Their dialogue is just espousing things that Godard is thinking about at the time. And, you know, sometimes they contradict each other, just like he is a very contradictory, I guess, intellectual figure, you know? That's why a lot of smart people end up not liking him, because of how much he contradicts himself, where as a cinephile, that's what I like, baby. But, you know, he puts forward this idea of, you know, that the concept of moving forward is to reject your past self. And what he wants to do is be in a strong conversation with his past self while rejecting time entirely. And, you know, that's said in some variation a few times in this. And I think stylistically, it totally makes sense, as the first hour calls back to what made him famous. These, like, on the Paris streets, beautiful film photography. And then you get that immense, you know, last 30 minutes washing over you of consumer grade digital video, oversaturated to hell, the colors just, like, bleeding through the screen, some of the most incredible digital work he's ever done. And it's not necessarily moving forward, it's just using history in the present sense. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what so many, that's kind of like what Histoire du Cinema is about in a way, and what so many of his films at this point are about. And it's kind of a hard concept to say. I probably sounded dumb trying to express it there. Mm-hmm. No. But I think he pulls it off wonderfully, and the images are just, they speak for themselves. They're some of the most beautiful images of his career.
Well, I mean, I think Godard's, like, sort of handling with his own legacy in the film, I think, broadly extends out to his critique of America. I know there's one thing, I think it's said, like, a few times, but there's no resistance without memory or universalism. Mm-hmm. And I think that applies very much so to, I don't know, left resistance in America in itself, where it's like the United States has never done a great job of reckoning with the terrible things that they've done in their past. Mm-hmm. And it just, all that stuff works really, like, he's speaking these clear truths that are like broadly universal, but also then personal to himself. It's just, I don't know. It's amazing that he pulls this off.
No, I mean, yeah, his attention to history is very, I mean, he's very explicit about that. I mean, characters will just be at a location and then, like, towards the end of it, it's like, you know what happened over there? Like, Caesar came in and, like, raided things. And I think it's very important to him, and it's stated so in the film, that, you know, works of art be shaped by history. And a lot of American art is ahistorical or even intentionally ignores history to create a more convenient current narrative.
So most of the anti-American sentiment comes out of the fact that in both movements of the film, the Americans are involved as a potential financier for this artistic endeavor. And the Americans the first time are, yeah, saying a bunch of dumb shit. It's a classic American accent, too. It's like, it sounds like the American guy in, like, 90s Hong Kong action
movies. I was thinking that, too.
Who's like, oh, that's the boss over there.
Bonsoir, monsieur. Bonsoir, monsieur.
And it's great that he includes that, because in classic Godard, you know, stereo splitting fashion, this is another one, you know, crank the stereo or even put on the cans for late Godard. You have a woman, you know, speaking about the history of, like, war crimes between, like, Serbians and Albanians, and the American, like, telling the sentimental story version of it, like a detached version of, like, there was a child who didn't have her mother.
It's a 12-year-old girl who tells me.
Pas un journaliste ne signala que la plupart des réfugiés se trouvaient précisément dans leur foyer lorsque la guerre éclata.
So they'll take away
et que les Serbes avaient averti qu'ils régleraient leur compte avec
my
les Albanais si l'OTAN s'en prenait à la Yougoslavie.
No, I mean, I think that's what I love about all these kind of dialogue scenes when, you know, characters are speaking to each other, because, you know, Godard likes to, you know, conflict himself, and, like, during these conversations, sometimes the camera will just be on someone who's not even really involved in the conversation, or it's like, we have characters always out of sync with each other, not quite, you know, always talking over each other and stuff like that. And it kind of, you know, it matches what the whole film is trying to do.
I mean, on top of that, like, contradictions and, like, the removed nature of the film, it's like Godard has this way of making, like, works that are so detached and, like, alienating in that sense, but also feel really emotional. Mm-hmm. Like, they're just, like, I don't know, because there's a focus on, like, I don't know, singular moments and scenes, because the narrative is so fragmented that they stand out, that, like, I'm always overwhelmed when there's an emotional quality to it, like, mm-hmm. particularly, like, the piano score really, like, mm-hmm. hits hard at certain points.
Yeah. Similar to another one I watched this week, Forever Mozart, the use of music in both of those. I mean, like, he knows how to be sentimental with music, and the fact that he withholds it so well is so much of his genius in terms of soundtracking his movies.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah, and just, like, how, you know, he plays with those aspects, like, this is something I remember in First Name Carmen, too, and I'm not as familiar with his, like, 90s work, but, mm-hmm. like, you know, it seems like a progression of this where, you know, he loves to, you know, kind of, like, start and stop, and it's, or, like, that's a weird way to put it, but, like, to, like, insert music at, like, kind of, like, slightly awkward times mm-hmm. and stuff like that, just so you kind of notice the difference.
And weird places in the mix compared to how usually movies are soundtracked.
Exactly. And, I mean, the way he messes with that and, like, with the new digital technology in, like, the last half hour segment, you know, it's how he's, like, stopping and starting the digital thing, or, like, you know, jerking with the zooms and whatnot. It's interesting to see him play with that type of nature in a new format.
I mean, in terms of, like, the technological parts of it, there's one line that I feel like is really relevant of history is replaced by technology, which feels, I don't know, the further we go into the digital sphere, it seems more and more that, like, overrides, like, any, like, we have the ability to sort of search into the past there, but sort of choose not to and let, mm-hmm. like, I don't know, a digital, fuck, I'm losing my train of thought here, but
yeah,
it's okay, because according to this movie, in order to think about something, you have to think about something else as well. Yeah, and this is said multiple times, and at first it seems like a classic Godardian platitude, but then it really comes into motion when it like or motion it comes to life when you see that like digital double exposure shot of a man's head and like the ocean when it's said the second time. And it's something he actually brought up in an earlier film in the 90s, JLG Self-Portrait in December, where he talks about how a landscape that's new to him is only new to him because he's also thinking about an older landscape that he's comparing it to. And again, you know, Jean-Luc Dialectics Godard, right? I think his use of like that thought, and I love how he's just repeating these thoughts that he has about cinema throughout his career, you know, and taking on whole new meanings because of the scenarios he's inserting them into and the images that he's putting underneath that voiceover, is endlessly fascinating. And then here it's under, yeah, that super saturated digital where sometimes you'll cut to a still frame that's so blown out and affected that you think it's a low quality version of a painting, because in digital, in this last half hour, he's also slightly in essay mode where he mm-hmm. will cut to a painting, you know,
yeah.
and overlay someone's face onto it like he does in his 90s essay films like Histoire du Cinéma and, you know, 2x50 and The Kids Play Russian and such films like that. Of course, you know, all these films always building up to the next ones in that way. And I feel like it's just such a summation of his work, and at the same time, such a moving film, especially in that last half hour. It's just, I don't know, one of the best movies.
No, yeah. And I think you saying it's like a good amalgamation of his work. Like, I think you were saying, like, there's enough, like, you were getting at, JT, that there's enough, like, narrative thread for someone to hold on to if they're less willing to go along with the Godard's antics. But, you know, those are some great antics. Mm-hmm. And but, you know, you're still getting kind of like the dialectical, you know, conflict that he's known for. And then you're getting some new digital, you know, late Godard, you know, film socialism, goodbye to language type stuff. So this is the, for your buck, this is the best Godard to purchase.
Yeah, you really do get, like, I mean, with the contrast of like old and new, it's mm-hmm. the most Godard for your value. Mm-hmm. This is a real good discount.
We're sounding like the Americans in buying the Holocaust drama from the grandparents.
Also, I mean, we talked about the use of the pickpocket poster earlier, but our old friend Brisson gets a second shout out when his book Notes on the Cinematograph is read from. Just like one of the great film nerd dumbass moments in a movie is someone reading from that book. I loved it. I had an ear to ear grin.
No, yeah, I definitely let out a big whoop when that happened.
So we went pretty long on the whole. I'm giving this one 5 bullets though.
I'm gonna give it 4.5 bullets. It's really great. I was really blown away by it, and I think you're right, JT, where he gets to be detached and emotional, and maybe it's just his strength in image making that allows him to get away with this. But I think he's also getting at something kind of with like a detachment in general, kind of like, I don't know, it's funny that he's interviewing all these people about like love and stuff like that, and none of the results seem to be, you know, chipper. But I really like this one a lot. How do you feel about it?
I'm going to give this 5 bullets as well. I love this. It's just like, I don't know. I have not been afraid to say on this podcast that I am a dumb guy.
Yeah.
And when going to Godard films, each time it feels like, I don't know, he's presenting a lot of information there.
Yeah.
But with like just the rapid fire images and ideas that Godard is presenting, there's a lot of stuff that you can individually parse out where mm-hmm. it's just like, I don't know, if you're chasing every reference or like trying to figure out everything in a Godard film, you're going to drive yourself fucking mad. But like on the whole, he expresses a lot of like fantastic thoughts and ideas through like juxtaposition mm-hmm. and just like even the Godardian platitudes that I feel like I would just be pissed off by other filmmakers doing, like when Godard has a character saying something about you're confusing existence with life. It's just like, that will like hit me and I'll be like, damn, dude, like you went there, Godard. And
what about the line like, my grandfather said he did not leave the Communist Party because of women, but because of persons of sex.
And it's just like, that shit is like, Godard like can be like fucking funny too. Yeah. Like,
he's one of the funniest filmmakers.
And like, not afraid to like go like pretty lowbrow, like not in this, but like there's like farting and shitting. And
yeah. Oh, I watched Forever Mozart earlier this week, and yeah, there's a lot of very low blows in that movie, and a lot of jokes about like, you know, whether or not the movie has enough knockers. Even this one talks about like how every movie has to have boobs, which is funny because that goes back to Contempt, where there's the scene of Brigitte Bardot just naked, like asking if the lead actor likes her ass, legs, like listing off all the parts, you know, and which was like a studio mandated thing, like, you know, this film needs more sex appeal. You got Brigitte Bardot, she's not even naked, you know.
No, yeah, like, you know, so many callbacks and references, you know, Godard makes, especially in these post new wave films. It's like, that's in, you know, made me invent a challenge, the Godard challenge. It's like, get everything he says in a movie post 1969.
Yeah, you got to catch them all. Yeah, there are just so many images that are just like overwhelming, that are just like, you kind of just have to see them for yourself.
Yeah.
Especially in that last 30 minutes, you know.
Oh yeah.
The double exposures, or I guess they're not even technically double exposure because it's digital. The overlays are just absolutely beautiful. And, yeah, that's about it. I guess we'll be right back to talk about Attack of the Clones.